Our relationship makeover series. Were y'all here last Sunday for singleness? Wasn't that amazing? Amen. Did it get you excited about being single? We want to hear you. You need to go on YouTube and get excited about being single. Amen. Because just as you're happy about single, you'll be just as happy when you're married. Because when you're single, oh, I wish I was married. And when you're married, oh, I wish I was single. Hallelujah. So be content where God has you at this very moment. Because He gives grace to both. He gives grace when you're single, and He also gives grace when you're married. Amen. So I'm going to prepare today's message by getting properly, putting on the proper attire. I'm going to do it in a second. This is Relationship Makeover Series Part 2. And the title of the message is 5 Ingredients for a Healthy Marriage Cake. Amen. I'm going to say it again. 5 Ingredients for a Healthy Marriage Cake. How many want a healthy marriage?
Amen.
Amen. If you're married today, who doesn't want a healthy marriage? Who doesn't want to get along with your spouse? Amen. Now, if they're not here today, just believe they're going to be sitting next to you. Amen.
Amen.
And you're here standing for them. So I'm going to put on the proper attire before I start making this healthy marriage cake for you. Because today, we're going to go to the Lord's kitchen and bake us up a marriage cake. Amen. And we have the recipe and the 5 ingredients that go into the baking process for a healthy marriage cake. So give me 1 second. Now don't laugh at me. Y'all laughing at me. Well, amen. Praise God.
Church say amen.
Church say amen. You gotta be a man's man to put one of these on. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. I'm gonna pull out my ingredients because we're gonna make a cake, right? How many of you men bake in the church? Y'all bake? Y'all bake at home? I got taught how to bake when I was little. Very little. By my mom and my dad. In case I ever ended up being single, I would know how to cook. Amen? But thank God that God sent me a helpmate that knows how to cook. Now look crazy. That's good. That's all right. We got to look crazy for God sometimes. Amen? So we're going to start with our baking ingredients. And I'm going to pull them out. I'm going to have my sous chef get these ready. My sous chef is going to be Pastor Delisa. If you can come up and get my ingredients out there. Even though most of the time in the kitchen, I'm the sous chef. She's the chef. You know what? Yeah, that's fine. That's perfect. And we're going to start with ingredient number 1. And that is honesty. Amen? And we're going to get honesty, and we're going to put the first ingredient in our baking cake and go ahead and splash it in there. And there's our first ingredient. And we're going to mix it at the end, but not just yet. Amen? Thank you, Susha. And before I go any further, I want to share a little story about the apron. Amen? There was a story of a young man, and he had come downstairs. He lived at home, and he was a young man. He was probably about his teens. And he just had it going on in his mind. He just had swag, he just knew everything, and he just had it going on. He came downstairs with his pants pressed, his shoes, he took a toothbrush to his shoes and was cleaning them real, just got them real shiny, amen? Came down with his shirt pressed, his jeans pressed, and came down with his hair, everything put in its place. And he sat down, and his mom looked at him when he sat down. He goes, "Son, you look good today." He goes, "I got it going on, Mom. I got swag, I'm going out, so I'm doing my thing." And so his dad starts to come downstairs. His dad comes down, his hair's all everywhere, and he's wearing a kind of a dirty shirt, looks like a little dirty, but his pot belly hanging out and his shorts, and comes downstairs and just worked a 60 plus hour a week job. And he puts on the apron and he goes in the kitchen and he's fixing to start making some breakfast for his wife and his family. Y'all gonna love this. And the wife and the mother of the young boy turns around and looks at her husband and says, "Now, son, if you want to know what it looks like to have swag," swag just means you got it going on, that's a young term nowadays, amen? And he goes, "If you want to see what it looks like, that's what it looks like right now. That man right there cooking in the kitchen with an apron, hair everywhere, pot belly hanging out, that's the man that has swag right there. And the young man couldn't understand what she was saying because they've been married 40 plus years. Anybody 40 plus years in the church today being married? Give him a hand clap. Amen. So the mom began to explain what it means to have that marriage intact because he couldn't understand it. He goes, look, son, my husband, your father, just got through with a 40, 50, 60 plus hour a week job, and now he's in there cooking on Saturday on his day off. Amen. And he does the dishes afterwards. Hallelujah. In my eyes, that's what attracts to me. That's what is attractive. And she said, you over here got everything going on the outside, but you got no job. You have no money in your pocket, and you're living at home with your parents. And he goes, and then he just sat there and looked at his bowl of Cheerios and was just convicted. Amen. So what does it take to have a healthy marriage? Number one is honesty. Honesty. To maintain absolute honesty with each other, number one, in order to have a foundation of mutual confidence. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 10, you can turn there if you like. I'll give you time to turn. Number one, maintain absolute honesty with each other. That is the foundation for any healthy marriage. Are you with me?
Amen.
It says, so we can have confidence in each other. It's a mutual confidence. And in 1 Peter 3:10 says, for the scriptures say, if you want to enjoy life, happy wife, happy life. We're getting into it in a minute. And see many happy days, keep your tongue from speaking evil and your lips from telling lies. This is the number one killer, everybody look up, in marriages. Is the tongue. John Osteen put a book out years back. It says, hung by the tongue. Life and death are in the tongue. Amen? And you can either speak evil over your marriage and your relationship, or you can speak life over your relationship. Amen? The one thing that my wife and I have established early in our marriage is being truthful with each other and being honest with each other. No matter how uncomfortable it is. And what that does, saints, is it lays a strong foundation for your marriage that you have mutual confidence that wherever I go in Houston, leaving the house, come on now, amen. She has confidence and where I'm going is where I'm going. And when I'm coming back at the time I say I'm coming back. Why? Because we've laid that strong foundation of being honest with each other. So she has confidence when I leave the house that she has no evil suspicions because I haven't put that there. So when I leave the house and say I'm going over, it wasn't always like that. Okay? We've been married for 16 years. And the first couple of years I had to learn about truthfulness and honesty in the marriage. And I didn't realize that every little white lie starts to build a bigger house. And then when you leave, because you planted so much in your spouse, lies that when you go out, you leave them at home open for the enemy's attack, for evil suspicions, and don't have the mutual confidence that when you leave, it's where you're going. Amen. Are you with me? Amen. That's a beautiful thing to have in a marriage. That when I leave, she has no problem where I'm going, because she knows that's exactly where I'm going. And if I go to anywhere else, I gotta take care of stuff and do things. She still has that confidence. She calls me, I pick up the phone. Amen. There's no, it goes straight to voicemail. Husbands, are you with me? Wives too, but you gotta keep that open flow of honesty with each other. It's so important. It can be restored, but it takes time. And it takes time through being honest and truthful. No lies. Do not speak evil over each other, but speak life over each other. You're hung by the tongue. When it comes to marriages, be careful how you talk to each other. Don't speak death over your marriage. When you get into an argument, don't be the first to say, I'm done, we're getting a divorce, I'm leaving. That should not come out of the mouth of a Christian marriage. Hallelujah. Amen. That should never be one of the bullets you pull out in your gun and shoot because you're emotionally hurt or emotionally angry. Amen. Hallelujah. And another thing is, don't leave angry either. We're going to get to that in a minute. Honesty. The first ingredient in us baking a healthy marriage cake. Hallelujah. Y'all got enough on honesty? That is a strong foundation. Because when you speak life over your spouse, you're making a deposit in your spouse. Every day we get up, I say, I love you to my wife. Now, to be fair, I inherited that from my parents because that was a lot in our house. We got used to saying, I love you, son, I love you, dad, I love you, mom, and they did it to each other. So how many knows you passed that down to your children? Hallelujah, I thank God for my parents because they're still married today. Amen. And you leave that inheritance with your children and they pick up on those things. But being in a marriage and being together, you have to learn to make those deposits and not always withdraw, withdraw, withdraw. Hallelujah. Amen. So you got to know how to say, thank you. You're welcome. Thank you. I love you, sweetie. Excuse me. You know, you get used to being with each other for so long that you get comfortable with each other, that you forget to be well-mannered with each other. Amen. And be polite with each other because, well, they're not going anywhere. They're just, so we treat them kind of ungodly sometimes. Amen? And we take them advantage. But the Bible says, if you want to see a happy life, if you want to see happy days, if you want to have that in your marriage, learn how to control the tongue. Are you with me? It's very, very important. Because when you're with each other, how many knows there's going to be some disagreements?
Right.
No disagreements? You got to be careful when someone says, we don't ever argue. We don't ever fight. Never fight, never argue. Okay, who you with? Something going on the side. Okay? You getting fulfilled somewhere? Ingredient number two. Hallelujah. Come on up here and let's get ingredient number two. Talk. Oh boy. Let's go ahead and put talk in there. Husbands, get ready. This means open communication between each other. Keep lines of communication open with each other. There must be a constant readiness to talk things out. Are you with me? When the steam is allowed to build in the boiler, an explosion is coming. Talking things out includes the willingness for each other to say, I'm sorry, and to forgive and forget. Amen. Ephesians 4. 26 and 27, if you want to turn there, or if you're taking notes. It says, you just hold your place where you're at. I'm going to just read it to you. It says, and don't sin by letting anger control you. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. Hallelujah. Because it says it gives the devil a mighty foothold. Open communication. Open talk. You know what? We got to talk. Oh, boy. Those words that come out of your wife. We need to talk. It just automatically, you know, something has to be talked between each other that's going to feel uncomfortable. But this must be one of the ingredients for a healthy marriage. Because if you keep the lines open for communication, nothing builds up to where there's an explosion. So if there's anything floating inside, down, way inside there, you got to get it out, husbands. You got to get it out, wife. Amen. Don't ever say to your wife, you don't want to talk. And don't be afraid to share that vulnerability with your wife. I have no problem sharing whatever I'm going through with my wife. That's my best friend. Amen. That's the person I go to and I vent. I let everything out and she's there to pray for me. She's there to receive me. Same way with me. We keep the lines of communication in our marriage completely open. Doesn't matter what it is, we talk about everything in our house. And that's the way you should be with your marriage. You never want to go to bed angry with each other. Because the Bible just clearly says it gives a mighty foothold to the devil. He'll grab that foot and he won't let it go because you think just sweeping it under the carpet that somehow the next day it's just going to vanish. It doesn't vanish. What happens is you've opened up the door for the enemy to come into your marriage because you didn't want to talk things out and you felt like it was just going to go away. It doesn't go away, husband. It doesn't go away, wife. What happens? It starts to build up in your spirit, like the water boiling. If you leave it boiling long enough, what happens? An explosion is going to come. And the slightest little disagreement, you're exploding on your wife, exploding on your husband because you didn't deal with the issue 6 days ago, but let it go by, and now you want to deal with it, but you're not dealing with it. The littlest things are going to set you off. Are you with me? Very important. You gotta keep a healthy talk between each other. Open dialogue, open communication, amen? And don't let the sun go down on your anger.
That's right.
Because what happens is when the anger sits there, it turns into resentment.
Yep. That's right.
Turns into bitterness. Turns into unforgiveness towards your wife, towards your husband. And then every little thing that he does or she does is going to get on your nerves because you didn't deal with what happened last week. You just put it under the carpet and expect it just to somehow vanish. Doesn't work like that, saints. You talk things out. Before we go to sleep, we could have had a disagreement during the day. I'll grab her hand. I'm a little more quick to make things right. Because, you know, as you're in a marriage and the longer you walk with God, you start to mature, amen. And the two words that husbands need to get used to saying is, I'm sorry. Are you with me? I'm sorry. Forgive me and I'm sorry. I have it in my text already just to shoot it off when I need to. Amen. I'm serious. You go in there, you know how it has already pre-programmed text. I got mine in there that says, I'm sorry, sweetie. There's nothing wrong with that. Amen. It keeps a healthy marriage. Who cares if you're acknowledging that you're wrong? You on that side are taking care of your wife and covering her.
Amen.
And letting her know that what you did was not right. Same thing with the wife. Amen. Be ready to apologize to each other. And if we have a disagreement during the day, we will lay there at night. And we can't even sleep because of the call on our life. If we have something that's going on. That there's an infraction here. Amen. And I'll look at her and say, sweetie, I'm sorry. You know, and I'll talk it out. And not just sorry, but let her know what it is I'm sorry for. So she understands I know what I'm apologizing for. Women want to know that, amen? Are you saying you're sorry because you just feel bad, or are you saying sorry because of what you did? I'm saying sorry because of what I did. Are you with me? So you talk things out. You learn to communicate with each other. And it takes time to grow in that. Especially if you're here today and you're courting with each other. You're learning. You're growing in a marriage. You're always growing. You're learning each other. And you're learning to talk to each other because you're married. You're learning to trust that person with all of your deepest, darkest desires and whatever it is you struggle with. You can discuss your weaknesses with her, and she doesn't judge you or look at you conditionally, but still loves you unconditional.
Amen.
Isn't that amazing?
Amen.
Just like our God in heaven. Amen. It's the same way in marriages, and you have to come to that place where you're just comfortable talking to each other about everything and anything.
Amen.
Come on now, even if it's the bad stuff. What do you mean by that, Pastor? We're going to move on. Ingredient number three. Are y'all already imagining the healthy marriage cake? We've already said honesty. These are the ingredients for healthy marriage. Number two is open communication, talking with each other. Don't let the anger go down. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. Because when we talk things out, when you talk things out with your husband, your wife, that next morning, I promise you, when you wake up refreshed. You wake up restored because there's nothing there. You already dealt with it the night before. Hallelujah. This is good. Think of it that way. You know what? We're going to deal with it now. We're going to get it out of the way. I'm not taking off. I'm not going to drive because I'm angry. I'll get to you second. I'm angry. You get angry, husbands. And mostly husbands that do this. Wives don't really have a problem leaving the house. But nowadays, do not leave that house angry. Husbands, come on. Do not leave that house angry until you talk to your wife about whatever's going on. No matter how hot the conversation gets and how heated it gets, don't leave the house. Talk it out. Because when you leave, husbands, the enemy will pounce on you. And you'll go do something to take it out on yourself. And it just doesn't affect you, but it affects your wife and your family as well. Are you with me?
Amen.
Is that good? Let's give God a praise.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, number three, we're going to do overlook. This is a main ingredient. This one's overlook. Number third ingredient in our healthy marriage cake is to overlook faults. Overlooking minor faults and imperfections. Hallelujah. Do we all have them? You better believe we do. You get to see them a little closer when you're married. Love covers a multitude of sins. Let's say it again. Love covers a multitude of sins. Amen? Love it. Don't demand perfection in your spouse when you are unable to produce it yourself. Are you with me? Go with me to Colossians chapter 3, verses 13. Now this one, I want you to see it for yourself. The five ingredients for a healthy marriage. And if you're not married, you're going to have this recipe for your marriage when you go into being married. That's why it's good for you single people. Well, I'm not married, so how does this apply to me? It does apply to you. Because if you desire a husband or if you desire a wife, these are very important ingredients to keep a healthy marriage. My wife and I know a few things. We've been married 16 years. Hallelujah. So we know the foundations of certain things to help you have a healthy marriage, especially when Christians are having a marriage in this last day, the world.
Amen.
Difficult, but not impossible. But God. Are you with me? Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. We're talking about overlooking faults. It says, make allowance. Does anybody get an allowance here? Some husbands and wives do, amen. For each other's faults, and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember that the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Why is this so important? Because when you live with each other, and this is just human nature, this is just our fallen nature, our sinful nature, that we highlight and we magnify the faults of others. Amen? And don't celebrate our strengths, but we magnify the weaknesses that we have in each other. And when you're living with each other, every little thing you're going to see that fault in the other person. To the putting the toothpaste cap back on the toothpaste. Amen? Putting the TP back on the roll. Leaving the seat up. Come on, can I just get real with you? Touching those decorative towels that you're not supposed to touch in the bathroom. Amen. You don't mess with those. You husbands, don't mess with those decorative towels. Hallelujah. Moving this over here in the kitchen where it's not supposed to be. That's not supposed to be there. That goes over here. If there's a husband, it don't matter, right? But the wife, she has a certain way. Amen. They have a certain way of things. And just go along to get along, amen? Those little things, you don't sweat the small stuff, amen? To you, it seems like this giant fault are these weaknesses and imperfections, but we make an allowance for each other's faults. That means that we are going to fault one another. In our marriages, especially because we live with each other, we're so close to each other, we see every little thing. But I want you to look at it this way, married people. The weak, because God is the one that puts husbands and wives together. Amen?
Amen?
When I found a wife, the Bible says I found favor with God. So God gave me favor because he sent me a wife. I must be doing something right. Hallelujah. Don't pray for just anything. Because God, the enemy will make sure that you get anything. Amen? You say, I want a godly wife. I want a godly woman.
Hallelujah.
And boy, I should have prayed a little different, but that's what I got. You get a godly wife, boy, certain things you can and cannot do. Amen? Because she's filled with the Holy Ghost. And so there's no lying that I'm going to get away with. And plus, the Diaz family, we're not good liars anyway. We got too many telltales. It just, no, I could tell you some stories, but No. Those are in the vault. No. Pastor Lisa, no, sweetie. Okay, so having an account, you keep that account open, it never closes. Because you know there's going to be times that you fault one another. And the thing I want to share with marriages, that married people here today, Christian married people, husbands and wives, celebrate those areas that each other are weak in. Why? Because those areas that I'm weak in, because we've been married for 16 years, those are the strengths that God has in her. Are you with me?
Amen.
And her areas of weakness, those are my areas of strength. So guess what? When we're together, it's powerful. Because we complement each other. So I don't look at the areas and magnify the areas of weakness, and she doesn't do that to me. But we celebrate our strengths, and we help each other with our weaknesses. Amen. And we make an allowance for each other's faults, and we're quick to overlook those faults. Why? Because love covers a multitude of sins. Amen? Because we're all sinful. And when you're in a marriage, you're going to see every little thing start to surface. And so you must have the spirit and the attitude of overlooking those faults so your marriage continues to be healthy. Are you with me?
Amen.
Don't let every little thing get on your nerves. We're not going to talk about the remote control and things like that. Because those things you can work out if you have a good relationship with God and with each other. Amen. It's my turn to hold the remote. I tell you. Amen. But you know what's great is because I watch all the shows she watches, so it doesn't matter. I like watching Lifetime and all that other girly stuff. Amen. It's all trauma, things like that. I'm comfortable in Christ and who I am. Amen. Come on now. Praise Jesus. So many stories, Lord. Okay, ingredient number four. Ingredient number four, and this is a very important one. Money. Oh boy. Money. Throw it in there. This is probably the number one, if not the main one, separates, divides, complicates, arguments, disagreements, is all rooted in money. Because we need money to live, right?
Amen.
Come on now. Work for unity in your finances. Amen. Avoid overspending, married couples, listening to me, and for you single people, but installment buying, putting things on credit, and the lust to keep up with the Joneses.
Amen.
Are you with me? Amos 3, chapter 3, verse 3. How can two people walk together unless they agree? Amen? Now, I love that, you know, what's mine is hers and what's hers is hers. That's the mentality of the world. Hallelujah. What's mine is yours, and what's yours is yours. You know? So, yours is yours. I got, you know, this is my money. I made this money. It's no my money anymore when you're married. Amen? It's a one. When the two come, they're one flesh. You're one body with your wife. Amen? The husband and the wife become one flesh. So your money needs to become one flesh. We know married couples that have, I have my own bank account. And I have my own, and I understand that there's certain situations where you may have, you're coming from different relationships and divorces and things like that. Amen? But I'm talking about those that are coming in fresh, you know, and God sees that where you have to come together with your finances, husbands and wives, having one bank account.
Amen.
And putting it in one bank account tells each other that this is no longer mine. And this is no longer hers, but it's ours.
Amen.
And we come together and pray. Every little thing that goes out of our household is discussed. To the buying a piece of candy. That's just how we run our household. I'm not saying be that strict. Walk in the convictions and the understanding, the wisdom God has given you. The main thing is be careful when it comes to money. Don't let money rule you. But use wisdom when it comes to finances. Don't overspend. Don't get into things that are going to cause hurt later. Use wisdom. Pray on everything. How can two walk unless they agree? There must be agreement. And if there's no agreement, we hold off until God gives us the answer. And we pray until the Lord gives us the answer.
Amen.
So many times we've gone together to purchase certain things, and we went with the intentions of buying something, and the Lord didn't give us peace. Maybe he gave her peace and I didn't have peace. Maybe I had peace and she didn't have peace. That doesn't mean you go forward. Come on now. How can two walk unless there's agreement? The Bible says there's power in agreement. Amen? Unless there's two agreement, you got to pay attention to that, saints. Especially because most of the time, my wife has had a lot of the insight when it comes to not having peace on certain things. Otherwise, I would have gotten us into a lot of mess. Are you with me? And I've held back and I've learned to appreciate my wife and not see it as her controlling me and trying to run things, but her giving sound wisdom and me learning to receive her as my helpmate when she gives me certain wisdom, because she might be a little further along in life with certain things when it comes to our finances, amen? Because I made a wreck of our finances in the beginning when we first got married. I didn't know how to handle finances. Hallelujah. But she knew how to handle finances. It's not some sort of, just wrong in me, but that God saw that I needed that area in my life. And that's the way you need to see it when you're with each other. Don't see it as she's trying or he's trying to control me or rule me or instruct me, but yet trying to love me and to help me and to better my life. Amen? Are you with me? And that's what she did. It wasn't always like that in the beginning. I could have avoided a lot of pain and suffering in my life if I had just listened a few things. But you know, husbands have a hard time sometimes listening to their helpmate. Helpmate does not mean you're in the kitchen cooking and cleaning and providing children for the husband and they do nothing but help in that manner. That's not what a helpmate means. When God gives you a helpmate, it's to help you along in life. Hallelujah. Amen. To strengthen those areas that you are weak in and vice versa. Are you with me?
Amen.
Everything is a working relationship. There's no competition. There's no I'm better than you. All that stuff needs to be put on the cross. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on now. Is that enough on ingredient four, on finances?
Amen.
Let's go put y'all's bank accounts together. Hallelujah. Ingredient number five. Woohoo! Hallelujah. This is the last. Did we miss some ingredients here? These are all my ingredients. Now, this is the final ingredient for our healthy marriage cake. Can everybody see that? It's the ingredient of love. Hallelujah. And I'm going to explain a lot about love. Because Hollywood has got it wrong. Don't let that be your benchmark for your marriage by looking at Hollywood and looking at all of the partners that they're in and out. Amen. That is not anything to do with the church. Hallelujah. Remember that love is a command. Well, I'm just not feeling it. I just don't feel it today. I'm just not feeling like loving you today. Amen? You did something to me. I just don't feel it. Hallelujah. I'm not going to love you because you said something, did something to me the other day. So you're not getting no love. No love. No love. No love. That'll carry into your sexual relationship as well. When you start to not love each other, you'll start shutting the doors in every area concerning your relationship with one another. The Bible says, do not defraud each other. Don't withhold from each other that which is required in the marriage. Hallelujah. It's a very beautiful thing, and it belongs in the marriage. And God gave it to us as a gift. And that's how we use it, is within the husband and wife.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Nothing wrong with it. Amen. But what's happened is that after years of being married, and I want you to hear this, because we see it all the time, I've just fallen out of love with him. I just fall out of love with him. Or I fell out of love with her. That's not love. Amen. Love is a command. Love takes some work. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Love endures all things. Love is peace, patience. Love is kind. Amen?
Okay.
Love is not lust. And that's where the world has it wrong, because they don't feel that that romance and that fire, it's not like it was in the beginning. It's not supposed to be like it was in the beginning, amen? You're friends now. You're in a relationship now, amen? Believe me, you don't want to go looking anywhere. And you won't have to if that main ingredient is in the marriage, and I'm talking about the sexual relationship with each other. It's in the book of Corinthians, chapter 7, if you want to go read it. Because it says when you come together, it defeats Satan from tempting you, both of you. Hallelujah. So that you can better walk. That's why Apostle Paul says, I want you to do what's ever going to make you serve me better. Whatever is going to cause you to be a better Christian, a better disciple for Christ, then that's what you need to do for your walk with the Lord. If being single is what's going to make you serve the Lord better, then God's grace will be there for you to be sexually pure and pour yourself into the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. But if you're someone who needs to have a helpmate, amen? I cannot do this on my own. The Lord knew that too, and I'm okay with saying that. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because that's the way God built me. I have the grace to be married to better serve God in the capacity He's called me to serve Him.
Amen.
Amen. So you got to know where you are when God calls you, that you remain. And what the world has gotten into a place, and that's why there's so many partners, divorces, is because somehow they feel that the love is gone. And that fire is gone. And so what they do is, you know what, let's invite a third party into our marriage because we need to somehow spice it up. Or you know what, we're going to do something to make things a little more interesting. And so they go and do things. In Hebrews 13, the Bible says, do not defile the bedroom.
Amen.
Amen. Even in Christian marriages, we are not to defile the bedroom. When it comes to husbands and wives,
amen,
we keep that pure. And that's all I'm going to say about that. We're church. Hallelujah. We're church. Amen. So, can't say certain things behind the pulpit. And we got pastors saying all kinds of stuff behind the pulpit with no filter, saying certain words, no reverence behind the pulpit any longer. And I'll give you as much as the scriptures give you. Amen. And that's what I'll give you. Hallelujah. So love in a marriage, 16 years, and I'm still in love with my wife.
Amen.
My mom and dad, 40 plus years, and they're still in love with each other.
Hallelujah.
Holding each other, hugging each other, holding hands in public. They're very affectionate, amen?
Amen.
That's a love that's enduring.
Amen.
And it lasts. It's not about all that other stuff, amen? And you got to understand, it's an ingredient, but it's not the whole. Most of your love and your relationship is going to be out here. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'll share this real quick story with you, and you'll get a kick out of it. I had this young man come to me. He says, Pastor, I was a brother at the time before I was a pastor. He goes, Brother, you know, I have this woman that I want to marry. And I start, okay, you know, as a brother in the Lord, or even a pastor, you start asking the questions. Okay, are they a Christian? Well, they say they go to church. Okay, at least they say they go to church. Are they saved? Well, she's not sure. Well, you've been serving the Lord a long time, and you're not sure. Okay, I said, what church do they go to? Well, I'm not sure. Boy, bro, this is a lot of not sures, but you want to marry this girl because she was skinny and long hair, and I could see where his heart was. Okay? Wasn't really concerned about her being godly. Amen? He just like the old pastors used to say, the filly in the closet. He wanted a filly on his arm. You know, when you start praying certain prayers, you got to be specific because the enemy is listening.
That's right.
Are you with me?
Amen.
I want the blonde and the flowy hair. And the enemy says, oh, yeah.
There you go,
buddy. And then you're thinking, God has answered my prayers. No, He hasn't. Mm-mm. First of all, you start finding out where the red flags are and where the warning signs are. You start testing the spirit. You start asking questions. Amen? Do you go to church? No. Bye.
Bye.
Why prolong the agony. Amen? It's not the Lord. Shut it down. So I gave all the wisdom that I had in my heart. You must not be unequally yoked with non-believers. Different for those who are married. Amen. And listen to me by the Holy Ghost. If you're married today and you got saved while you were married and your husband or wife's not married, the Lord says it's okay. Your marriage is still sanctified. Because if you're serving God and that other person isn't, they still have that influence around them, and God's mercy is on your marriage because you came that way. Now, there's no mercy there when you decide to say, I'm going to go ahead and marry someone outside of the faith. Guess what? You're going to head for a lot of problems. Amen. Amen? That's why we're here, Christian. Don't get into something and say, God, okay, I married this person, but they were in the world. Now, fix them up, God. I'm trying to save you a life of heartache. We don't do mission dating in here, amen? I'm on a mission to date that one who's lost. I'm going to get them saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, and then get them matured in God so they can start, I can marry them. No, no, no. It doesn't work that way. It does not work that way, amen? So the man came to me. I gave him all the wisdom I had. He told me, Brother Jesse, it's going to be the greatest love story ever told. It's going to be the greatest love story ever told. He was pretty arrogant about it. And I already knew the direction he was going in by marrying a worldly woman. I told him time and time again, do not marry this woman, brother. She's not for you. She's going to hurt you. Well, I'm asleep in my house, and by my window, there's a window by the bedroom. I hear this. And it's in the middle of the night. It's late. I look out the window, and this brother's right here. Oh my gosh, what is going on? So I remember going and meeting him, and we went to the backyard and my parents' house. I was at the time, like I said, before I got married, and I was really a pastor, and I was already going to Bible college and whatnot. And we sat down on this little bench in the back. Brother Jesse, he already gotten married. I warned the brother not to get married. I said, don't get married, brother. It's been a year already, it's gone by, he's been married with her. And he sits down on that bench, he looks at me and goes, brother. I said, what's up? What's up? I almost said his name. Brother. I said, what's up, brother? He goes, it's not the greatest love story ever told. I want to feel bad for him. You know, you want to feel bad, but brother, you have all the scripture, you have all the wisdom I could have given you. I tried as much as I can, but you know what? You gotta go and try it for yourself sometimes. But God's word always. It lasts and it stands the test of time. It doesn't change if you just apply yourself. Do it the right way. My wife and I, we started courtship, and I knew I loved her, and I knew I wanted to marry her, and we stayed pure in our devotion to each other. That means no sex before marriage. Hallelujah. I'll say just as plain as the Bible says it. Amen. Because that's fornication. And what it does, a lot of young people, they genuinely love somebody. And they might have where they want to walk with that person and may have a relationship and want to be with them for the rest of their life. But they don't understand that when that sex comes in, that curse comes in too.
That's right.
And it ruins the relationship. Yes. Are you with me?
Yes.
Now for the lost, they don't know any better. You don't go preaching this to the lost. No. Hey, hear me by the Holy Ghost, saints. This is for the children of God, amen?
Amen.
Come on now. So when I got together with my wife, we made sure when you're courting someone, do what you know to do to keep yourself pure with each other. Don't be in front of the TV by yourself watching the movie, just you and her, and you're not married. Come on now. You got to have accountability. Do things that are going to protect you. Make no provision for the flesh to rise up. Don't think you're stronger than the flesh. Amen?
Amen.
Are you with me?
Amen.
Well, we courted, and then we knew each other for 2 years, and then it was like six, or how long was it before we got married? About 5 months. But we already knew each other. When you're courting, I promise, take a year or two to get to know each other before you decide to get married. Let that courtship go on a little while. We like to say a year, maximum 2 years, so you really get to know who that person is, because they still have the mask on. They're still, you know, dressing sharp and saying the right things, and let some trials come along and let some of that mask melt off and see who that person is, if they truly are the God man or the God woman that you want to be with for the rest of your life. Are you with me? Amen?
Amen.
So, you know, I went to my dad and said, hey, Dad, I want to marry this woman. But our finances aren't right yet. Your finances ain't going to ever be right, son. Boy, he hit me right through the, right between the eyes with that one. So I said, you know what? They're not. And they're still kind of, you know, everybody's finances. It's just one of those things. So I said, you know what? You're right. What's holding me back? Nothing holding me back. About a week later, I just looked at her and I said, hey, you want to get married? That's the way I proposed. That's the way I proposed. Am I right? I was on the couch because we were such good friends. It didn't have to be like the world. That was my best friend, amen? And I looked, I was so comfortable with her. Boy, when you're comfortable with that person, you better hold on to that person, amen? Because that person isn't judging. They love everything about you. That's why you feel comfortable. And I knew what I had. So I looked at her and we're on the couch watching the movie, and I think Sister Patty was in the other room because they lived together, Bert and Sister Patty. And I looked at her and said, so what do you want? You want to get married? She said, yes. Yes. I said, why don't we get married? Okay, that was it. We got married. Boy, y'all thought it was going to be some romantic, me getting on and saying da-da. And it wasn't nothing like that, amen? It was so special, though, because it was so genuine. It came from my heart. Love is the final ingredient. And if you want to know how to treat your husband or your wife, this is the way you go and you understand what love is. Go and read 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and read it with your wife. Read it with your husband. Love. Love covers a multitude of sins. Learn to say I'm sorry. Learn to forgive. Learn to love each other in spite of it all. Listen to this. It says love is courteous, for instance. It will keep you from criticizing or contradicting your partner in front of others. Love will keep you from fighting in front of your children, which could disrupt their sense of security. And we're going to go a little more in next Sunday about the children and the dynamics of the Christian family and everything that goes into a healthy family. Our third installment of our Relationship Makeover series, and Pastor Delisa is going to be taking care of that. So we got all the ingredients. Amen? Come up here, Pastor.
Amen.
And I want y'all just to see this here. Oh, my. So here it is. We just did a little mix, okay, amen? Now come on over here a little bit with me. We put in a little honesty. We put in a little communication. Are you with me? We put in overlooking minor faults. Let me get a little into this. Hold on. That's the way you do it, right? I know how to cook, amen?
Sure.
I do. I know how to cook. Making finances, because, you know, in case I was alone. So, but God can see, I'm not leaving you alone. So finances, cooking up the finances. Boy, we're making a healthy marriage cake today. And the last ingredient is love. And this is what you get. Amen?
Y'all saw how fast I cooked that up? You brought that out of the oven back there. Look at that. Amen?
Y'all have to, let me have the mic. You have to remember that place when you first got married with each other. When you looked at her like that, and she looked at you like that, amen? I love this, go ahead and hold it for me. You got it? I love this, the little people down there, because I like how the man's real slim and real, looks real lean. I like the woman, how she's real lean, even her arms are real lean and everything. Amen? You can see it right there. They look like a young couple just getting married, amen? When you love someone and you truly fall in love with that person God has given you, it doesn't matter what happens as you get older, because as you get older, this begins to change. This expands a little bit. Amen? But I don't see none of that. I see the woman that I fell in love with still that day when I said I do. Amen? Because I fell in love not only on the outside, but most importantly the inside. I fell in love with her spirit. She had such a love for God. She had such a peace about her, such a joy. And I still have that today. And I told her the other day, I said, sweetie, I love you more today than I did. I know it's cheesy, but it's real. It's truthful. And I told her, I said, I love you more today than yesterday. I'm more in love with you today. It's because, you know, we go from glory to glory when you're in the Lord. And it feels as we grow in God, we grow with each other as well. And I see her every day and I'm like, I appreciate her so much. I said, sweetie, I couldn't do this without you. I couldn't. And I appreciate my wife. How many should, y'all should celebrate each other every day. that you're not alone.
Amen.
And if you are alone, you can celebrate too because you're with Christ.
Amen.
Amen. And if you stay connected long enough, God will bring that one to walk alongside you. So we're going to do something a little special. You can go ahead and put the cake down. Now we're going to close with kind of a ring ceremony. Amen. I have five ingredients that we just did that go into making a healthy marriage cake. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now I want you to go back and bake your marriage cake and see God move in your relationship. Hallelujah. Now everybody who's married, I'm talking about married couples only. Are you with me? Now if your spouse isn't here, I still want you to come up. But being married is being married under the eyes of God. I'm not talking about living together and somehow you feel in your mind, you're thinking it's, that you're married. You're not married. Make it right, get it right. Now that you have the understanding and the revelation, make it right in the eyes of God. If that's the person you know that you're to be with and you're living together, get married so that God can bless your relationship. All of what goes on most of the time is because there's no union there. Amen? So if you're married today, I want you to come up and this is what we're going to do. You're going to come up. If your husbands and wives are here together, if you're not, you're going to still come up. And you're going to grab one of these little jewel boxes. These jewel boxes have two rings in them. And I'm going to tell you what the rings symbolize after you get together and come up and get your little jewelry box. Come and stand. And you can all line up here at the altar. I'm going to say a blessing over you. Amen. Now everyone go ahead and grab one. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Husbands and wives, just one. Y'all just need one. That'd be four rings. Because if you open them up, there's two rings in there. And they're looped together. And if your husband or your wife's not here, that's okay. Because what you're doing is you're standing for your wife. You're standing for your wife. You're standing for your wife. You're standing for your husband. Standing for your husband. Y'all are standing for your husband. Y'all are together. Standing for your husband. Amen? And I'm going to share with you what the ring means. I want everyone to close your eyes. And I want you to hear. Because God gave me these words. So the rings that are inside these boxes, they're given as a sign of the love and devotion you both made to each other. Isn't that beautiful? The ring that you wear that was placed on your finger by your spouse on your wedding day represents your commitment to your marriage, your love for your spouse, your faithfulness to this relationship, and to make God the center of everything you do. And I'm going to say a blessing over you. Everybody in the congregation, I just want you to stretch your hands. Because it's difficult, and it's hard, and it takes a lot of work to keep a marriage going. Amen? But God, Father, right now I thank you for everyone that is up here. Lord, bless them above all that they prosper, be in good health, even as their soul prospers. Let them be the man and the woman of God that you called them to be, Lord. And let love be their highest goal in their marriage. Holding an allowance for each other's fault. Let love cover a multitude of sins. Father, I speak a blessing over their relationship. Every word that was spoken over each other that was hurtful, let it be removed right now, Father. Everything that was lodged into their heart, may be uprooted now. Every bit of unforgiveness being let go. Hallelujah. And I speak the love of the Lord Jesus Christ over every one of these precious couples in your sight, Lord. And I thank you, Father. Upon leaving this church, they're going to see the change in their life and in their relationship with each other, Father. As they go forth and pour that love out on each other. Hallelujah. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. And we say, amen.
Amen.
You can be seated. Hallelujah. Get